What is DCC and why do modelers use it and how does it work? We're going to go over those questions and a little bit more in this video right now. So let's get going with it right now. I'm Tom Kovichak and this is Tom's Trains and Things. This channel was created to help other modelers who are in need of guidance in pursuing their dream of building a model railroad. And if you want to use DCC, you're going to want to watch this video right here. Without getting too geeky about it, I'm going to explain a little bit about what DCC is, what components you're going to need for your layout, how to wire it, and possibly what is the best DCC system for you. Before we get started, I just wanted to let you know that there are a lot of different methods, a lot of different uses that are out there for the model railroader. There are as many opinions about DCC as there are modelers. With that said, I'm going to tell you what NMRA suggests, what the manufacturers suggest, and what modelers have done and what I have done. So with all of those put together, maybe you can make a good decision on what you want to do with your DCC layout. So let's get started with that right now. What's the difference between DC and DCC? So in DC, you have a voltage on the track that controls the track. You can only have one device on there, and you're adjusting the voltage on that track to make your locomotive go slower or faster. On DCC, you're sending a signal through the track with a constant voltage, and what you're controlling are individual devices. So with DC, you can control one device from a power supply. On DCC, you can control many devices. There are five basic components for a DCC system. Now, some manufacturers combine some of the components together, but I'm going to give you the five right here. First one's a power supply, then the command station, throttle, the throttle network, and a decoder. Now, I'm going to talk about each one of them right here. The power supply is the unit that supplies the voltage to your command station, or if it's large enough, a booster for the command station to supply the power to the tracks. DCC has a higher demand for a constant and higher voltage than DC. The throttle is a controller for your system, usually a handheld. Now, it can be located in the box, the command station itself, like in a Zephyr, but most of the time it's handheld and it is brand specific, so you can't mix and match throttles with a different command station. So if you're using Digitrack's throttle, you can't use it on a NCE system and vice versa. Now, the throttle network is the cabling between your throttle, your command station, and your track that goes to the decoder in your locomotive or a stationary decoder. The command station is the heart of your DCC system. This has a microcontroller in it that is the encoder. Now, it takes the information from the throttle, encodes the information, sends it out into the throttle network to the decoder. There are two types of decoders, a stationary decoder, which I'll put a graphic up over here, and a mobile decoder. Now, here is a mobile decoder right here. This is an N-scale one. It's a Digitrax DN136PS. Each decoder has a microcontroller in there that does the opposite of the encoder in the command station. It analyzes the signal and turns it back into DC to operate your motor, your lights, your turnouts, whatever it may be. There are two other components worth mentioning for the DCC systems. Now, they're not required, but they are used in many systems. The first one is the programming track. I'll put up a graphic of it right there, and also a booster. Now, a booster can double as a command station, and some can be used as both, but only one at a time. And a booster is when you have a larger system and you need to increase the voltage on your track further out away from your command station. And that is a discussion that is beyond this video right here. We'll talk about that later in another video. But anyway, I wanted to mention that both the programming track and the booster are optional items in your DCC system that you have to think about for expansion. Let's take a look at how DCC really works. I'm going to bring up a couple of graphics on the screen to show you this. And as you can see on the left-hand side, it's an AC waveform, and on the right is a digital waveform. Now, on the sine wave on the AC waveform goes right here. This is the positive. This is zero right here, and this is negative right here. Now, the same thing on a digital waveform. The only thing that's different, as you can see, there is no smooth transition like a sine wave. It has a square top and a square bottom. This is the positive, this is zero, and this is negative. But with DCC, everything is above zero. So there is no negative. At the top of the waveform, you have your maximum voltage, and when you get down to the bottom, that's zero. So that's the big difference between an AC sine wave and a DCC signal. What you see on the screen right now is a DCC packet. It starts out with it's what's called a preamble, and this lets every component on the DCC system know that that's the beginning of the signal, and over here is the end of the signal, and these are the instructions in here. Now, after the preamble, it gives an address so it knows which component to talk to. Now, it could be a locomotive, it could be a DS64 to control turnouts, it could be signals, it could be lighting, it could be anything. After the address gives the command, whether it be blow the horn, turn on the lights, increase the speed, whatever that command is, and then the end of the signal. Now these signals, these packets that go through the wire and into the track, there are 8 to 10,000 hertz. So that means there are 8 to 10,000 cycles per second. So this is a lot of information that's going through the bus wire, the feeders, and the track up to the locomotive or to your other components. There are suggested minimum wire sizes for your bus wires in each scale. Now, that is the minimum requirement. Now, NMRA has a chart, and DCC Wiki has a chart, and I'm sure there's a lot of other charts out there that'll tell you basically the same thing. But there's another thing that you have to take into consideration, and that is wiring complexity. And what I mean by wiring complexity is how much are you going to be hooking up to your system and how long is it going to be. Now, what I do is I put my command station in the center of my layout. Now, I have 10 foot going across one side, 17 foot from one side, one end to the other, and then 10 foot going back behind here, as you could see. Now, that is 17, 27, that is 37 feet, and it takes a loop around, and it takes a loop around on this side also. So you can imagine that is a lot of distance, but with the command station in the center, so I'm only going 18 feet actually in each direction with my bus wires. So I'm well under the 20 foot range. Now, on most of these charts, they go from 1 to 20 foot, and then from 21 to 40 foot, and so on up. And I'll put a chart up here showing you that. But what I'm talking about in the wiring complexity is detection blocks, transponding, reversing sections, signaling, and computer assistance. All these things have to take into consideration because you have a voltage drop and you have change in amperage and change in resistance while you're doing this and adding all these components and features to your DCC layout. Now, you have to remember Ohm's law in here. As your resistance increases, your amperage decreases. So I'm going to go over this little thing right here. Having more voltage will cause overloads. So you don't want to have too much voltage on your system. You want to have the correct voltage and have it set at the close to the maximum voltage for the scale that you are using. But having less current available will hamper your booster and your train operation. So keep that in mind, because as your resistance increases, your amperage decreases. And that's what we're looking at here. Less current. So with less current, you're going to run into problems. And let's say one thing about your tracks and your bus wires. NMRA has the recommended practices. Different manufacturers have their recommended practices, and 25 modelers have 25 different recommended practices. But the best thing to do is make sure that your bus wire is large enough and you have it connected enough through your system. Remember, most tracks nowadays are nickel silver. Nickel silver is high in resistance. So you want to use a bus wire, and the heavier the bus wire, the less resistance. And when you're running things in parallel, remember Ohm's law. Your resistance is going to be less than the least amount of resistance in your conductor. So your bus wire is going to have less resistance than your nickel silver track. So whatever the resistance is on your bus wire, it's going to be less than that, according to Ohm's law. So you want to keep your bus wire as heavy as possible. Don't scrimp on the bus wire. And now, I've read this in so many different places, I'm going to get flack for this. Do not rely on rail joiners to conduct the electricity through your tracks. And here's my experience with it. When you put your rail joiners together, you have a good connection. But with the changes in humidity, the changes in temperature in your room, it's going to continue to move back and forth as the humidity changes and the temperature changes. And when that happens, you're going to lose conductivity between the rail joiner and your track. So make sure that you have enough feeders going from your bus wire up to your track. Now, some people say 6 to 8 feet. Some people say every 3 feet. Or some manufacturers say at each track section. So if you're using a 9-inch track section, put a feeder up onto each one of them. Now, that's entirely up to you. I would go a minimum of at least 3 feet. That's what I did here. The way that everybody tells you to check if your command station is going to cut out with a short is to put a coin across the track. Now, that's the best way to do it. Go to the furthest part away from your command station and put it down there and see if it'll knock out the signal. And if that does, you're good. Check it a year after you've done it and see if you got the same thing. And if you do, you're still in good shape. The biggest question today is, what DCC system is the best for you? And what I'm going to suggest is, it all depends on your wants and needs. You have to research what you're going to do. You have to have a plan of what you're going to build, how you're going to expand on it, what you eventually want to have on your layout, and work from there. I suggest go look at all the manufacturers and see what they have and see how that fits into what your plan is. And that is how you decide what is going to be the best system for you. There is no one best system that is best for everybody. It all depends on what you want and what you need. So you have to make that decision on your own based on what your criteria is and what you want. Just go and do the research. You can find everything online. All the manufacturers have instruction manuals. They have PDFs that you could download, you could read, and you could see everything that they can do, and you base your decision on that. I only scratched the surface of DCC in this video, so I'm going to do a couple additional videos coming up in the future, going a little bit deeper into different areas of DCC. Now, I did a lot of videos on Digitracks and programming of your locomotive already, so you could see those in the playlist on DCC and Digitracks. Go check them out. If you continue to ask questions about DCC, I'll continue to answer them and I'll put that into videos. So go ahead, check out my webpage, tomstrainsandthings.com. You can learn a lot from over there, and we'll see you.